Deeper Life Bible Church program, Moment of Transformation. Today, by the grace of the Lord, we shall listen to our pastor, General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye. You are going to be blessed. It is my wish that you call your family to come and listen to you as our pastor is blessing you with his holiness message. Be blessed.
Important message. But you know that no matter what you hear, no matter what you read, and no matter how much time we spend on the word, our goal, our desire should be the end product. It's not just you, not just to come, not just to hear the word. What is the impact of the word in my life, in my family, in the church I belong to, in the web of relationships or the network of people around me? What impact is the word I'm hearing? What impact is it making? The thing we need to understand is that God wants to make a change. You call it a transformation, whatever we call it, a change. As we look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed. That's the word you want to hold on to. We're changed. It says we're changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. It says we behold him. We look at him. We examine his life again. And we try to analyze that life and ministry again. And then we look at our own lives and we see the distance or the difference between where we are and where he is. And then we begin to ask ourselves, how do we get from where we are to where he is? That should be the result of the things we're hearing. And that should be the purpose of this convention. That is, here is where we are. And here is there he is. How do we get from where we are to where he is? If that is going to take place, there's going to be a movement. And it's going to be a movement in the right direction. You want to. It's not where you are now. It's the direction you're facing. And it's the direction you're moving that determines the end result of what you get at the end of the day. And I've been thinking about it. I think about it not just for people I preach to. I think about it for myself. And I say now, the minister needs a change. The man needs a change. Here is this man. And we look at him now, and here is that man, the man of Galilee. And here is that man, the Son of Man. And we look at the man here now, he is ordinary. And we look at that man there, the man of Galilee, or the Son of Man. And he is extraordinary. And then I'm asking myself, why would Jesus Christ have to come here? The Son of God became the Son of Man, that the sons of men may become the sons of God. And I pick that up, that Jesus Christ came from glory. And as Jesus Christ came from heaven, that's the Son of God, he became the Son of Man. But I say, but why would he do that? So that we, the sons of men, may become the sons of God. He wants to bring many sons unto glory. Then I'm asking myself, is that being done? Are we just having church? Are we just having convention? Are the sons of men being transformed? Are they being changed? Are they becoming the sons of God? I mean, in the real sense, are they becoming like that man of Galilee? Are they becoming like that Jesus Christ, the Son of Man? And so then I'm asking myself, change the man. Change the man. That first of all, the man standing on the pulpit, change the man. Is there something that needs to be changed in me? You will not know. I only can tell if I allow the Spirit of God to talk to me. And he says, what's your goal in life? I want to be like Jesus. Talk like Jesus. Walk like Jesus. Pray like Jesus. Think like Jesus. And just do everything so that I have that resemblance of the Son of God. Well, then the man needs a change. Write that down. The man. The change. If the change is going to come, the change will have to come to the man. And I say, but what's the man? Who is the man? And then I now begin to see the mind is the man. The mind is the man. If the man is going to have a change, his mind must have a change. Be ye transformed in the renewing of your mind. You know, it's not just what we hear. If what we hear does not affect our mind, if what we listen to does not really get into our mind, the man will never be changed. And so as we, you know, come in, even the medical doctors will tell you now, the effect of the mind on your success, the effect of the mind on what you attract, the effect of your mind on what comes around you, the effect of your mind on your destiny, the effect of the mind on your health. The mind. And it is when the mind is changed, then the man eventually will be changed. I'm asking myself now if my mind is going to be changed. And what else am I looking for? Number three now. I'm talking, number one is the man. Number two is the mind. Number three is the model. I wonder who Hitler had been looking at as a model. I'm wondering who Winston Churchill was looking at a model. Because you always look at somebody before you, and you're always thinking, I want to be like that. At least I know that happened to me when I was in school. Of all my teachers, this one came in and taught, this one came in and taught. It wasn't really the subject, you know. It was a teacher. And I said, I'd like to be like this teacher. That was a model. At that time, I didn't know that I was choosing him as a mentor, as a model. But I just loved the way he carried himself and the way he came to the subject and the way he did everything that he did. I said, that's who I want to follow. And then I'll be asking myself, whenever I'm studying, whenever I'm alone by myself, I'll say, will my model do this? Will my model say it like this? And when I became a teacher, I just modeled everything at him. You see, if you're going to change the man, you'll change the mind. You'll change the model. And if you've had the wrong hero, and you'll be looking at the wrong hero, and you pick your hero from the media, just like, you know, this great pop singer, great man that died recently, and, you know, somebody here in New York, one of the politicians, had to say, why is it we're kind of adoring and exalting a pervert? You know, somebody was bold enough to say, why is it that everybody is just moving around, swirling around, and it looks like what we are kind of adoring and exalting, this is the wrong personality. Yes, I know that, you know, some people say, how could you say that? Never say anything wrong, anything negative about the dead. He's gone. Say everything good about him. But the man was concerned, and we can be telling the church, who are we lifting up as a model? And who are you? Because if you don't have the right model, you're not going to have the right mind. You're not going to focus on the right thing to do. That's the reason why you want to change the man, change the mind. And then change the model. And then you also need to change the meditation. What you meditate on, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You will meditate therein day and night. That you'll make your way prosperous. You'll have good success. It's what we think about all day long. What do you think about? What is said about me? You're thinking about the wrong thing. You're meditating on the wrong thing. If you're meditating on the Word of God, the Word of God is sent to us to transform us and to change us, to turn us around, and to make us the kind of man, the kind of woman, the kind of pastor, the kind of minister, the kind of member of the church we ought to be. But it depends on what you meditate on. And I asked you whether you are here in the morning. Those of us who are here in the morning, did you meditate on what we heard, the desire, and what you acquire, and what you inquire and how you perspire, how you inspire, and how you retire, get away from the crowd, and then you can come back and refire. Are you meditating on anything like that? Because the meditation will take you to a particular level. You'll be able to say, here is what to do, because you are meditating on the right thing. Without meditation, we're not going to be changed. It's not just what we hear, and it's just not just because we're coming to convention or we're there all the time. There is the meditation. Let that change. It will change. I said it will change. Now, another thing that will change in the mind, if the mind is going to change, that's my mouth. My mouth. You know, it doesn't matter what you know. If something comes out of your mouth every time, like what came yesterday is what is coming today. What came last week is what is coming today. And the mouth has not had a change. You're going to scatter all your friends with your mouth. You're going to attract more enemies with your mouth. And you're going to attract defeat and failure with your mouth. The things you say, out of the heart of man comes whatever we say, what comes out of the mouth. And if the man is going to be changed, the mouth must change. And I don't think there's anybody here that will say, I think I'm all right the way my mouth is. I think there can be an improvement. We can move from where we are and get to where we ought to be. And it is the change in such a thing like this that is what is going to be a change for the man. And we don't want to be like, you know, all the other churches coming for convention or going to their convocation or going to, you know, wherever they go, camp meeting, and as it was, so it is, and so it will ever be. I pray this church will be different. That something will happen that will know a change has come upon the man. A change has come upon his mind. A change has come upon what he meditates on, upon his meditation. A change has come upon his mouth. A change will come on the measure. The measure. You know, what you get measured gets done. If you have a goal, if you say, here is where I'm going, but you're not measuring how you get there and what progress you have made and what progress you have not made. You're just walking from day to day and acting from day to day. You never measure anything. How do you measure? Do I love today more than I loved yesterday? Do I believe God today for things I couldn't believe God for yesterday? My interaction and my relationship with people, my interaction with people, is there any change? Is there an improvement on my interpersonal relationship? There must be the measure. And of course, you must also have the right measure. Because if you don't have the right measure, you'll be congratulating yourself that I'm making progress when there was no progress at all. We need to say all this so that we know why we're here. So that whatever message we're preaching and whatever message we're hearing, we will know that the purpose, the end line, the bottom line is the change of the man. And if the man is going to have a change, then the mind must have a change. His model must be the right model. And the meditation must be there. And also, he must have the right kind of mouth and the right kind of measure. I pray the Lord will do it in Jesus' name. Can it be done without, number one, disappointment with myself? I'm disappointed the level I am now. I'm disappointed I've not gone beyond this. I look at those apostles of Jesus Christ and I see that they only spent 3.5 years with the Lord Jesus and see the measure of their knowledge and their output and the things they did and the places they went and the impact they had. And I've been with the Lord now for more than 3.5 years, for more than double that, 7 years, and see the way I am. Number one is the disappointment. You are disappointed that this is still where you are. Number two then is the decision, that you take a decision and say, hey, there must be a change. and there's nobody that will make the change for me. I'm the one that has to decide that a change will come. And it's that decision that gets you started, that gets you going the right direction. And then, of course, I'm sure you know that you determine the direction if you have decided. And then you want to climb the ladder. Please, before you start climbing the ladder, watch and look at the wall where the ladder is leaning. And look at the top of that ladder. Is that where you want to reach at the end of climbing? Because some people just spend all their time climbing the ladder and they never look at where the ladder is leaning. And then they get to the top of the ladder and they say, wow, I've wasted my life. This is not where I wanted to be. And I've been laboring and climbing the wrong ladder or the good ladder, but leaning on the wrong side of the wall. Look at where you are climbing and you decide the direction that you are moving. And then you now determine and say, I'm kind of the owner of this life. God gave me this life. And what I make of it, it was what comes out. I'm not going to allow anybody to determine or dictate what I do, where I go. This one life must be useful to the Lord. And it is when you do that, by the grace of God, with that gumption, discipline and diligence, you're able to get to where you are going. Your destiny will be on the right hand side of the Lord in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. Now tonight we are talking about the seed of Abraham. Abraham's seed with Abraham's faith. Abraham's seed with Abraham's faith. We're looking at the seed to start with. Number one, there are natural seeds, there are spiritual seeds. And what we're concerned about today is the spiritual. But let me show you the natural. We're looking at John chapter 8. In John chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 33. John chapter 8, verse 33. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? They said, we be Abraham's seed. As tonight we're talking about Abraham's seed with Abraham's faith, is this the kind of seed we're talking about? The natural seed? The seed of Abraham, the descendants of Abraham, the people that came out of the loins of Abraham. The answer is no. Look at verse 37. I know that she are Abraham's seed, but she seek to kill me. I know that she are Abraham's natural seed, and you seek to kill me. These are not the kind of people we're talking about. The natural ones, those who are born by Abraham, born by Christian parents, born by religious people. We go beyond that. We're looking at Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9. We're looking at verse 6 or through to verse 8. Romans chapter 9. Reading from verse 6. Not as though the word of God has taken none effect, for they are not all Israel that are of Israel. Think about that. They are not all Israel that are of Israel. That is, it's not the people that show up physically. The people that are there in body. The people that are there in the physical. And the people that lay claim to Abraham. Abraham is our father. We're children of Abraham. We have the seed of Abraham. It's not all those people that are actually of Israel. Then it says in verse 7, neither because they are the seed of Abraham, that is natural, are they all children. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called, that is, they which are the children of the flesh. These are not the children of God. They which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God. By the way, it's the decision of the individual that makes him either a seed of Abraham in the real sense or is thus naturally born. You don't have any choice in the fact that you are born by Abraham or the descendants of Abraham. No choice.